looking at cellular automata as computers is a huge subject, worthy of a course in and of itself. Here, I'll just give a cursory overview, but I've put some readings on the optional readings section of the course materials webpage for you to look at on this topic. Let's first talk about what we mean by computation. Computation is the processing of information. In a computation, information is input to the system. It's stored in memory in some way. It's transferred from one part of memory to another. And it's combined with other information. And this could also be called processed. Finally, the processed information is output for the user or the whole system to use in some way. So, a little sketch, we have input, and then a program, which performs the computation, and then output. Sometimes, for example, in a dynamical system, the output would go back and become the input. There's a notion that's very important in the field of computer science and in the field of complex systems, which is the notion of a universal computation. Basically, universal computation is the phenomenon of a computer being able to be programmed. That is, a universal computer is a computer that can run any program. So it's like the computer on your desk, if it only had an infinite amount of memory. Then it could run any possible program and compute any possible function that was computable. So the idea here is, instead of just an input, we have an input and a program. This goes into a universal computer, and the result is an output. You can think of this as the computer on your desk, where you input your data. There's a program that's been input by either by you or by somebody else that's in the memory of your computer. Your computer acts as a universal computer and runs that program on that input, and then it creates the output. One of the triumphs of the field of computer science was the discovery that only a small set of logical operations is needed to support universal computation. By support universal computation, I mean to be able to build a programmable computer. What this means is that if you can implement a particular set of logical operations and use them and combine them in different ways, you will be able to, in principle, have a computer that can run any program on any input. That's a universal computer. As I mentioned earlier, John von Neumann was one of the first scientists to look at cellular automata as models of complex systems. And in particular, he was looking at the idea of self-reproduction in machines, or automata. He built a cellular automata, a two-dimensional one. Each cell could be in one of 29 states, and this cellular automaton could replicate any pattern that was input to it, including itself. This is a schematic picture of this kind of self-reproduction. Here's a complicated machine. It has an input space or an output space, and it creates a copy of itself or any other pattern that you want to give it. Von Neumann also made it into a universal computer. That is, this can not only self-replicate, it can compute any computable function. Many people have simplified von Neumann's self-reproducing automaton to have fewer states, but it was the first creation of a universal computer inside a cellular automaton. The game of life has also been shown to support universal computation. In 1970, John Conway showed that life can implement the simple logic operations that are needed in principle for universal computation. He also sketched how a universal computer could be constructed. Then in the 1990s, Paul Rendall constructed the universal computer. Here's a picture of part of the universal computer that he constructed. It's a little hard to see, but it uses some of those structures we looked at earlier, such as gliders, glider guns, and so on, to implement these logical operations needed for universal computation. I have to say that this is a fantastically complicated undertaking to actually implement this kind of computation in a cellular automaton. For a long time, Stephen Wolfram suspected that some elementary cellular automata could support universal computation. This would be significant in that elementary cellular automata, if you recall, are extremely simple. And the question was, could the complex behavior that they created be complex enough to implement this most powerful form of information processing? Well, Wolfram's hypothesis was that all class 4 cellular automata can support universal computation. Remember, class 4 were those in between periodic and chaotic, those edge of chaos cellular automata. This hypothesis is hard to evaluate. Well, one problem is there's not really a formal definition of class 4 cellular automata. Also, it turns out to be very hard to actually prove that some system is capable of universal computation. However, Wolfram and his colleague Matthew Cook were successful in proving that rule 110 can support universal computation. This proof was described in a long chapter of Wolfram's book, A New Kind of Science. You can actually read this for free online. I've put a link at our course materials webpage. It's a rather technical proof, but the general idea is that Rule 110 supports these so-called moving particles, that is, these localized structures that move in space and time. Remember, time goes down the vertical, space goes along the horizontal in one dimension. And so these moving particles can integrate information from different spatial locations and collide with one another. So for example, let's see, here we see this particle colliding with this particle and creating a new particle. And the idea is that information can be stored in these more regular patterns, transferred via these particles, and processed via the particle collisions. In principle, these can support universal computation. In practice, however, it's hard, if not impossible, to actually program these cellular automata to do any useful task. While universal computation in cellular automata is very interesting, and even surprising given how simple they are, especially the elementary CAs, it's not a very practical way to perform computation. It's too slow to simulate a universal computer in a cellular automaton. It's also too hard to program. So no one really does computation for any practical purpose by using the universal computational abilities of cellular automata. However, CAs have been harnessed for more practical parallel computation, for example, in the field of image processing. I'm not going to talk much about that here, but in the next subunit, I'm going to talk about one particular project in which genetic algorithms were used to evolve cellular automata to perform practical computations. Finally, let me just say a few words on the significance of cellular automata for complex systems. Well, you've seen that cellular automata are really idealized complex systems that can produce very complex behavior from simple rules. We've seen that natural complex systems can be modeled using cellular automata-like architectures, and that cellular automata give a framework for understanding how complex dynamics can produce collective information processing, that is, information processing that emerges from a collection of simple components in a lifelike system, where lifelike means decentralized, relatively simple components, limited communication among components, and so on.